as she still had time for a cup of coffee before work, she probably saw David at about 6:40 a.m., maybe a little earlier. Denise Laney, who lived only a 5-minute drive from the home, gave more crucial evidence about timing, but again, it was imprecise. Laney, who had worked as an enrolled nurse at the home for 6 years, drove up every street and saw David squeezing past the partially open gate of number 65. I remember it because I got quite a fright, because I thought, help, I'm late, because I would normally see him at the bottom of the hill. I carried on, but I wasn't late. It's just a routine I have in the mornings. It's just I like to be punctual, she said. She checked her car's digital clock, which said 6:50 a.m., and, as it was usually about 4 to 5 minutes fast, she assumed it was about 6:45 a.m. If that time was accurate, she would have been late for work, but she was sure she wasn't. After seeing David at the gate, she still had a 10-second drive up the hill and then had to park her car and walk down the steps to work. Laney said her car clock should not be relied on for accurate timings. Laney made 2 formal statements to the police, the first on the 27th of June 1994, 7 days after she saw David. The police officer who took the statement checked her car clock and found it was 5 minutes fast. Laney was interviewed by police again in March 1995, just before David's first trial, and she repeated her view that she had seen David at about 6:45 a.m. because her car clock usually ran 5 minutes fast. Her first statement was admitted by consent at the first trial. David's lawyer did not want her called in case she backtracked, and the jury asked for the statement to be read a second time, clearly thinking her view on the timing was significant.